Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, the early Christians observed with great devotion the days of our Lord's passion and resurrection, and it became the custom of the church that before the Easter celebration, there should be a 40-day season of spiritual preparation. During this season, converts to the faith were prepared for holy baptism.
It was also a time when persons who had committed serious sins and had separated themselves from the community of faith were reconciled by penitence and forgiveness and restored to participation in the life of the church. In this way, the whole congregation was reminded of the mercy and forgiveness proclaimed in the gospel of Jesus Christ and the need we all have to renew our faith.
I invite you, therefore, in the name of the church, to observe a holy Lent by self-examination and repentance, by fasting and self-denial, by reading and meditating on God's holy word, and by prayer. John Wesley, founder of Methodism, was convinced that living truthfully is a mark of God's grace actively at work in our lives. Because we are made in God's image and our destiny is to be restored to the fullness of that image, we need to discern how we are meant to live now according to God's good purposes. Such intentions for faithful living also have been the desire of those who have gone before us and are reflected in the 51st Psalm, a Psalm of David. Let us experience this responsively. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love.
According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions.
Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin.
For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me.
Against you, you alone have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless in your judgment.
Behold, I was born into iniquity, and I have been sinful since my mother conceived me.
Behold, you desire truth in the inward being. Therefore, teach me wisdom in my secret heart.
Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow.
Make me hear with joy and gladness. Let the bones which you have broken rejoice.
Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me.
Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit.
Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you.
Deliver me from death, O God, God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your deliverance.
O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall show forth your praise.
For you have no delight in sacrifice. Were I to give a burnt offering, you would not be pleased.
The sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. The symbolic use of ashes upon the forehead is an Old Testament tradition conveying a sign of penitence, grief, and mourning. It is a reminder to us, remember, O people, thou art dust, and unto dust thou shalt return. Would you bow your heads in prayer? We come before you, O God, aware of our sinfulness and our shortcomings. Remembering our baptism, the watermark of the cross upon us, we also remember years when we have begun Lent by receiving the mark of an ashen cross. Both water and ashes are signs that in life and in death we belong to you. Though we cannot receive ashes in your sanctuary this year, still we acknowledge that only by your gracious gift are we given everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, remember that you are dust, and to dust you shall return.
Through these 40 days of Lenten vigil, help us to see the price of all our sin. Teach us how prayer makes strong a faith that's fragile. Confront our sinfulness within. Show us the cross that Jesus bore to save us. let that change begin. Help us to walk the servant's way with Jesus, to see past self, to care for others' need. Help us put down the worldly things that please us, to reach the outcast with a kindly deed. Then may the meaning of Christ's passion seize us,
the trumpet in Zion. Sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. It is near, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness. Like blackness spread upon the mountains, a great and powerful army comes. Their like has never been from of old, nor will be again after them in ages to come. Yet even now, says the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning. Rend your hearts and not your clothing. Return to the Lord, your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and relents from punishing. Who knows whether he will not turn and relent and leave a blessing behind him, a grain offering and a drink offering for the Lord your God. Blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the aged, gather the children, even infants at the breast. Let the bridegroom leave his room and the bride her canopy. Between the vestibule and the altar, let the priests, the ministers of the Lord, weep. Let them say, spare your people, O Lord, and do not make your heritage a mockery, a byword among the nations. Why should it be said among the peoples, where is their God? Have you ever seen the home improvement shows on HGTV or the Discovery Channel? They take a home in need of repair and send the homeowners away. Before they put up new drywall, before they install the deep tub or the farmhouse sink, before the hardwood floors are laid or the fresh paint is applied, there is demolition. In a lot of these shows, you'll see them tear out cabinets or walls, create that open concept. Sometimes they'll take the whole place down to studs. Inevitably, they find something, a major plot twist, an unexpected expense. It could be water damage, termites, or if you're lucky, some major foundation damage. It's usually a structural problem that threatens the entire project. And you know what they do next? They call the homeowner. I mean, the cameras are rolling. They can't wallpaper over it or put a temporary fix with some duct tape and hope that no one notices. They tell the homeowner and they fix it right. Because you see, the homeowner's coming back. The homeowner decides if the project is a success. No one wants to get to the big reveal and find that the homeowner is upset. That'd be terrible. The prophet Joel is warning the people of God The homeowner is coming back. Sound the alarm. Get ready. Listen to this particular line in verse 13. Rend your hearts, not your clothing. See, this isn't a cover-up job. This is about examining our hearts. It's about looking for major defects, structural issues. And when we find that problem, that habit, that addiction, that sin, we tell the homeowner. We confess. Why? Because he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and relents from punishing. Then we declare a fast. We deal with it. We tear down anything that separates us from God. We ask forgiveness. We plead for mercy. Lent is about demolition, humility, and confession. Unlike some of the home improvement shows you've seen, we aren't the contractors. We are the house. You see, the coming of Jesus isn't merely about God among us. It's God with us. Sanctify the congregation from the infants to the elderly. All of us are to be pure in our motives and in our love for one another. Injustice needs to be dismantled, poverty eradicated, inequality eliminated. See, before we can install peace, hope, and joy, we have some work to do. And it's a community effort. We are the dwelling place of God, and the inspector is coming. We, not as individuals, but as a people, we need to be ready. Lent is the journey of demolition, preparing our hearts for construction. Joel warns the people of God, there is no true renovation without demolition. This is the humility with which we await the coming of the homeowner. We wait in the house of the Lord. We fast. We weep. We mourn. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Come home.
Find a home near to you.
As I marked myself with the cross, I was reminded that in some traditions, the words used by a pastor or priest when ashes are applied during Ash Wednesday worship are these: turn away from sin and be faithful to the gospel. One sin we can strive to turn from is the sin of forgetting that God is with us in all our trials and all our troubles. In the epistle lesson for Ash Wednesday, the Apostle Paul writes an honest explanation of what he has gone through as he has preached the gospel of Jesus Christ. May his words encourage us to turn from our sin and be reconciled to God. It's in 2 Corinthians 5, verses 20b through chapter 6, verse 10, that Paul writes, "We entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. As we work together with him, we urge you also not to accept the grace of God in vain. For he says, 'At an acceptable time I have listened to you, and on a day of salvation I have helped you.' See, now is the acceptable time. See, now is the day of salvation. We are putting no obstacle in anyone's way," Paul continues, "so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we have commended ourselves in every way, through great endurance, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, holiness of spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God. With the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, in honor and dishonor, in ill and good repute. We are treated as impostors, and yet are true, as unknown, and yet are well known, as dying, and see, we are alive, as punished and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing and yet possessing everything." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Pastor Andrew shared words from the prophet Joel and posited that Lent is a journey of demolition that is necessary for reconstruction to occur. Now we consider words from the Apostle Paul that also are helpful as we begin our Lenten walk to the cross. For surely Paul preached the cross, and as his second letter to the Corinthians powerfully shows, he lived what he preached. Now, Lent wasn't a thing in the first century church. Paul never conducted an Ash Wednesday service for the Corinthians, nor did he write his letters to be used in the liturgy for Lenten worship services centuries later. But hearing from Paul tonight about how he remained strong and focused through his well-documented suffering surely can encourage us in whatever suffering we must endure. For in the midst of all his difficult circumstances, Paul preached a gospel that looked suffering in the eye and urged hearers to live with hope and with confidence in God's new creation. Just three verses before tonight's passage, Paul wrote this: "If anyone be in Christ, there is a new creation. Something old has passed away. See, everything has become new." Does that sound familiar? His words remind us that God's love is not something we must earn. We have that love today. Nor is the grace of God something we must seek. We have that grace today. For now is the day of salvation. Through the best of times and the worst of times, we belong to Christ, here and now and in the future. That's easy for me to say, and harder at times to remember. I woke up 2 days ago feeling like my world had crashed down all around me. I don't know what the trigger was that caused so many emotions to pour out of me all at once. I just was feeling sorry for myself for a lot of reasons, probably because of stresses of the past year. I retired from full-time ministry. I've had some periods of severe pain. I've had COVID and 2 surgeries and lots of physical therapy. It's been way too long since I've seen our younger son who lives 800 miles away. Not to mention the Packers lost another playoff game. Those were not in order of importance, but in chronological order. And of course, I'm just plain COVID weary, as so many people say. I, that's a lot of eyes to focus on, I confess it. Well, later in the day, when I forced myself to return to work on this message, I realized how much I needed Paul's reminder that God's reconciling power is at work in the midst of present sufferings, and that it will prevail. I needed the reminder that God offers hope, not just of bliss in the distant future, for the work of reconciliation has already begun in Jesus Christ. As a Christ follower, I am called to believe and to share that extraordinary good news. Indeed, it is a privilege to share it as an ambassador for Christ, now perhaps more than ever. For as we all recall, it was during Lent last year that all of us had our lives upended by the pandemic. We never expected to go through 2 COVID Lents, did we? In fact, in some ways, it's like we've already had a year of Lent as we've mourned those who were lost these past 12 months. And have been reminded daily of our own mortality. Still, as we begin now another walk to the cross, I hope we will all commit to intentional self-examination, confession, and repentance during Lent. For I am sure that growth and renewal or rebuilding will happen. Yes, the trajectory of our lives is uncertain, but God is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. So friends, let us not accept the grace of God in vain. And may we live as if we believe Paul's proclamation that now is the acceptable time. Now is the day of salvation. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
have one final scripture lesson for us this evening before we come to the Lord's table. And it's not from the mouth or pen of Joel or the mouth or pen of Paul. We encounter Jesus teaching us in this foundational teaching from the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 6, verses 1 through 6, and then 16 through 18, which say, "Beware of practicing your piety before others in order to be seen by them, for then you have no reward from your Father in heaven. So whenever you give alms, do not sound a trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, so that they may be praised by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you give alms, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your alms may be done in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, so that they may be seen by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door, and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And whenever you fast, do not look dismal like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces so as to show others that they are fasting. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that your fasting may be seen not by others, but by your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And so, yes, on this night we begin the season of Lent, remembering our fragility and our need for God. In the February 10th edition of Christian Century, I came across something that sounds an awful lot like what Pastor Janet was just telling us. This preacher wrote that on Wednesday, February the 26th, 2020, people all around the world gathered in churches and received a smear of ashes on their foreheads. Barely 2 weeks later, COVID lockdowns swept over the United States, and indeed the world, making that smear of ashes one of the last liturgical actions many of us experienced person to person, skin to skin, before the long period of social distancing, mask wearing, and worrying over case positivity rates. It's fitting, this preacher wrote, perhaps, that a reminder of our mortality would be the setup for what has been an unflinching season, highlighting our own vulnerability. And so here we are, 1 year later, again in Lent, a 40-day season of spiritual preparation. And we begin this journey with Jesus telling us, "Beware of practicing your piety before others in order to be seen by them." Piety, to be pious, the quality of being religious or reverent, marked by or showing reverence for deity and devotion to divine worship. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement that became the United Methodist Church, he penned the general rule of discipleship, and he talked about works of piety, practices that refer to as acts of worship and acts of devotion, these piety. Acts of worship are the social, public works of piety. They're what Christians do when they gather together. It is public worship. It is hearing or sharing the word. It is coming before the Lord's table. But the acts of devotion are the personal works of piety, our work for Lent. They are practices performed alone with God. And John Wesley recommended three: personal and family prayer, reading the scriptures, and fasting or abstinence. Well, in the text I just read for us from Matthew, Jesus names three, three personal acts of piety, of devotion, and speaks of them in such a way as there's just this assumption that these are three things that everyone who is walking after God is already doing. And in this season of Lent, we are called to engage in all of them, in giving of the alms, in praying, and in fasting. Alms, the giving of money or clothing to the poor and the needy. Alms, prayer, and fasting. We love our neighbor by sharing our resources sacrificially. We love God by uniting with God in prayer. And we love ourselves through fasting from that which takes us away from God. And so, alms. Giving alms is a way of serving others, to be sure, but it is also a means by which we show love for God. Friends, we cannot love God without also loving the world and the people in it that God cherishes. Prayer. Prayer may be communication with God, but it also allows us to love our neighbors and ourselves because of the way it changes us. Prayer changes us. Lent needs to be marked by personal prayer, conforming us more to the image and the likeness of Christ. When I was in seminary, or just out, I watched with some other pastors the film The Shadowlands. I don't know how many of you saw it. It's the story of C.S. Lewis, and Anthony Hopkins played C.S. Lewis. And in this movie, he gave one of the best definitions and rationales for prayer. He said, "I pray because I can't help myself. I pray because I'm helpless. I pray because the need flows out of me all the time, waking and sleeping. It doesn't change God. It changes me." John Wesley, in reflecting on prayer, wrote, "God does nothing but an answer to prayer. On every occasion of uneasiness, we should retire to prayer, that we may give place to the grace and light of God, and then form our resolutions without being in any pain about what success they may have." But finally, it's this fasting. And we live in a time of excess. We don't want to abstain from anything. As I said earlier, we love ourselves through fasting from that which takes us away from God, but it also helps us focus more clearly on God's role in our lives. Many have a tradition of giving something up for Lent, and that is a form of fast, as long as what motivates it is of a spiritual dimension. I don't think simply giving up chocolate is a spiritual discipline. When you fast, you empty yourselves and become more aware of your dependence upon God's good gifts of food and drink that sustain your life. Fasting also places you in solidarity with the people of the earth, for whom fasting is not a choice, but a reality that there is no food, and Christ suffers with them every day. And by the way, Wesley encouraged Methodists to give alms to the poor when they do fast. And so Jesus encourages us to do these three things, yes, during the season of Lent, but throughout our lives. Alms, prayers, and fasting or abstinence. And so the question is, what motivates you to do these things? Do you do these things? God and our relationship with the divine, and not the notice of others, is the only pure motivation. And so, friends, let's take this 40-day season and let's really get the most out of it. May this be a spiritual season for each and every one of us as we approach the cross and the empty tomb. Amen. Let us take time to be holy.
Take time to be holy.
as we pray together, when each pastor says, in the name of Christ, who faced the cross, you are encouraged to respond, we humbly pray, O God. Merciful God, we are your servants. We are forever marked in the name of Jesus who died. Give us grace to remember our baptism into Jesus' death and our hope of being raised like him to life, like his. In the name of Christ, who faced the cross,
we humbly pray, O God.
God of all the earth, your whole creation groans in pain, waiting for redemption. Guide us to be faithful caretakers of the earth and to guard the lives of all your creatures. In the name of Christ, who faced the cross,
we humbly pray, O God.
God of all the nations, heal the wounds that we inflict on each other. Break the barriers of race and clan. Grant an end to conflicts around the world that all may live in peace. Grant to our own country and its leaders the will to seek your justice and to remember the needs of your children. In the name of Christ who faced the cross,
we humbly pray, O God.
God, you are the Father of all consolation, the Mother of all compassion. Comfort those who grieve and those who are dying. Bring your healing touch to the sick and sustain those in trouble of any kind. In the name of Christ, who faced the cross,
we humbly pray, O God.
Mighty God, the love of your Son, Jesus, abides in us, and your Holy Spirit anoints us to forgive, heal, and baptize in his name. Guide your church to proclaim the gospel in unity, and work for your reign of peace. Give us a holy Lent and prepare us to observe with devotion the time of our Lord's passion, death, and resurrection. We ask this in the name of Christ who faced the cross.
We humbly pray, O God.
And so, friends, sharing in the Lord's Supper on Ash Wednesday helps us to focus on the spiritual and physical strength that we need for the journey ahead. You are encouraged to take bread and juice right there in your own homes, and so that we can share together in this time of remembrance. And so we begin with the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, creator of heaven and earth. You brought all things into being and called them good. From the dust of the earth, you formed us into your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. When rain fell upon the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, you bore up the ark on the waters, saved Noah and his family, and made covenant with every living creature on earth. When you led your people to Mount Sinai for 40 days and 40 nights, you gave us your commandments and made us your covenant people. When your people forsook your covenant, your prophet Elijah fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. And on your holy mountain, he heard your still, small voice. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. When you gave him to save us from our sin, your Spirit led him into the wilderness where he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights to prepare for his ministry. When he suffered and died on a cross for our sin, you raised him to life, presented him alive to the apostles during 40 days, and exalted him at your right hand. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. Now, when we, your people, prepare for the yearly feast of Easter, you lead us to repentance for sin and the cleansing of our hearts, that during these 40 days of Lent, we may be gifted and graced to reaffirm the covenant you made with us through Christ. And so, on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on this community of faith and all your people everywhere. And Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. And so, as the children of God, let's join our voices together in praying the prayer that he has taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen. And so I invite you at home now to receive the bread of life and the cup of blessing.
Thank you.
Almighty God, how wide, how deep is your love. Walk with us as we seek to walk with you over these 40 days. Amen. O love, how deep.
Deliverer, you led your people of old through the wilderness and brought them to the promised land.
Guide now the people of your church, that following our Savior, we may walk through the wilderness of this world toward the glory of the world to come.
These things we pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.